Alrighty, I think we're almost there.
Oh, I see it says live.
Okay, I think we're almost there, Marla. All right, so let's see. Okay. Yep, there we are. Fantastic. Hi there, Marla.
Hi, Angel. This is so exciting.
It is so exciting. I'm so pleased to be with you today, Marla, and I'm so grateful for you carving out this time with me today. I'm so excited.
Me too.
So, yeah. So I want to go ahead and introduce you to my audience first, and I'm going to read directly from your bio, but I want people to know that I have been following Marla's wonderful work for so long on LinkedIn, and we've always just touched base with each other. We share so many commonalities and interests, not the least of which is yoga. So I want to introduce Marla Pelletier, who owns Inward Office. She is the CEO and owner of Inward Office, a mindful yoga, meditation, and fitness company that was, get this, established in 2006, 14 years ago. Marla and her yoga therapists deliver on-site and virtual workplace wellness classes. Inward Office instructors teach in person in Western New York, and they teach virtually nationwide. Marla received her teacher training many, many years ago in Mysore, India in 2006 after leaving her corporate job. Inward Office's mission is to teach somatic techniques that grow inner resilience, manage physical and mental stress, and foster healthier lifestyles. Marla is a certified instructor in Hatha and Raja Yoga, mindful eating awareness based on the research of Dr. Jean Christeller, yoga for anxiety and depression, and mindful yoga for veterans. Yoga Nidra is offered for deep rest, mindfulness-based stress reduction, and Nada and Mantra yoga. Marla lives in Rochester, New York with her husband and four beautiful children. Oh, Marla, that is so, so, so much. And I'm just really, as I said, grateful for you being here today, for sharing your experiences, not only as a business owner, but also as a mom, and also to share what yoga looks like in the workplace, why that's even important in general, but even more so now as we're all faced with a global pandemic that we seem to be sort of stuck in. And so we're going to dive into all of those really good things. We don't have a whole lot of time because, as I said, Marla's got, you know, her business that she's running and four children. So we're going to dive right on in there. And Marla, if you can just tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, and how you came to decide on this as your career path, because you said you left the corporate setting.
Yeah, I started practicing yoga right after college and went into a job like my parents wanted of me and I expected with my degree and everything, and went into advertising. And I found it hard to merge my daily work life with my daily yoga practice. And at the time, my husband was getting an MBA in entrepreneurship. And he was also starting a business. I was working the corporate job, and I was like, I really want to teach yoga. Mm-hmm. And so he was really foundational in helping me take the risks that have actually benefited thousands of people at this point, but take the risk to leave my job, spend a bunch of money going to India, doing a teacher training there. And then I came back, you know, jobless. And just dove right in. And I think it's the person that connected us, who was the first to buy into our programs, who's Shaquana.
Yes.
Is a common friend. And so she was really the first there, but really the motivation from the beginning was I just knew. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I just knew that it was my desire to keep up my own practice and deepen my self-awareness. And I knew offices could use that for the balance because so many of us are in that doing mode when we're at work. mm-hmm. That we needed a little bit more of that being mm-hmm. mode mm-hmm. to mm-hmm. overall find balance. And they were already doing it in India quite pervasively. So that was also like a vote of like, this is going to work, you know?
Yeah. So that's what I want to ask you, because I really do, you know, I know why you probably chose to go to India to do your training. Mm-hmm. And I'd like you to share with your audience, because, you know, people know there are thousands and thousands of programs here. What was it mm-hmm. that was particularly important for you about saying, hey, I want to go back to India to do my training? What was specifically, mm-hmm. I mean, I have it thought in my mind, but share with others yeah. what was really special and unique about that for you and yeah. why that was meaningful.
Well, I mean, one level of it was, frankly, my family is Indian. Mm-hmm. Me going to India just, you know, brings together a deeper level of integration.
Yes.
Because my dad was born and raised in India, and so he had some of that, you know, latent knowledge of Ayurveda. Mm-hmm. My mom had practiced yoga when I was young and when she was pregnant. So there was, you know, these kind of themes, of course. Mantra and the pujas and the visits to the temple, just, you know, the religious aspects were already in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And so going to India wasn't a huge leap for me. Mm-hmm. And I did have a lot of, at that time, trouble finding who was going to teach me. I was trying mm-hmm. to find them from America
mm-hmm.
and then make the trip to India mm-hmm. knowing where I was going.
Right.
and so that was hard because I was calling teachers in India and trying to figure out who was best and took a leap of faith,
yeah.
You know, sending over my dollars before I arrived, hoping right. that everything was going to work out. And also the immersion in India, that particular program was a full 2 months of mm-hmm. like 10-hour days.
Oh, wow.
And then I spent 2 months at that program. Mm-hmm. Then I spent another month at an ashram. Mm-hmm. Then I spent another month at Rishikesh, which is the birthplace of mm-hmm. yoga. They call yes. it right on the river Ganga.
Mm-hmm.
And then another month visiting my family. So I spent 5 months there really diving into this practice. And I didn't want the teacher training that was 1 weekend mm-hmm. a month.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But now as a mom of four and a professional, I mm-hmm. fully, fully see the value in mm-hmm. that style. But at that point I was a newlywed. I was somewhat free mm-hmm. of, you know, motherhood and
yeah,
household.
Absolutely. Yeah, so, absolutely. Free from the confines of parenting and motherhood yeah. and yeah. all of that. And, you know, that's so important that you mention that, because I'll be honest about it. I kind of feel like with many of the mind-body practices, whether it be yoga, Tai Chi, Qigong, so much gets lost in translation. A lot of it gets watered down. And so to be able to do what you said, which is to immerse yourself in all the limbs of yoga, not just the asana practice,
mm-hmm.
but also the spiritual practice, the yeah. pranayama, all of it, just the whole system of medicine, because I don't think many people really realize that yoga is a whole system of medicine, you know, the meditation yeah. piece, the Ayurveda, all of that kind of thing. So you were really yeah. fortunate at that point to be able to have that as your foundation mm-hmm. and know all of the different ways that you could translate that to a Western audience in yeah. a meaningful way. And I don't think you can do that unless you have that whole foundation, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think that there's a lot to say about diving in deep. Mm-hmm. You know, I definitely could have done it a little bit more, you know, I don't want to say surface level, but mm-hmm. integrated with everything else going on in my life.
Sure.
And instead it was like, this, you know, I really believe at its core yoga is a way of life. Mm-hmm. I mean, whether you're vegetarian or you eat meat or you, I don't know, or a policeman or mm-hmm. a teacher, whatever you do, I still think it has a way that it does change your life. And I think you even said that recently in a post, right? You said that
yeah.
was one of the most foundational things you've done. And,
yeah.
and there's so much, again, like you said, asana, the physical posture is only mm-hmm. 1/8 of the practice meant to
yes.
clean the body.
Yes.
Like to clean the body out to mm-hmm. allow for other states of awareness.
So. Exactly. And I, in that post, which you're mentioning on LinkedIn, I mean it. I mean, I have done a lot of different things. I've done Tai Chi. I still do Tai Chi, Qigong.
Yeah.
And I always say nothing meets me in my whole life the way yoga meets me in my whole life. It's not, it's really something that I live every single day. It's how I work. It's how I govern myself in my friendships, relationships. And I think when you get that, like in here, it just changes so much. And it's such a beautiful, beautiful way of living. Tell me this though, you mentioned that you said, I knew right off that I wanted to offer this in the workplace. And that's really significant because we're talking 2006, that's 14 years ago. Mm-hmm. You know, we're just now starting to talk about like workplace wellness. And you know, Shaquana, who we were just talking about, our mutual friend, she was on this page a long time ago also, which is workplace wellness and seeing the workplace as some place that is, you know, we spend 8 hours, 9 hours of our life at work, right? At 5 days a week, sometimes six for some people. That's a huge portion of our life. And if you start working at, you know, fresh out of college, 18, 20, whatever, for the next 30 years until you retire or 40 years, I mean, assuming you go from one job to another, that's a significant portion of a person's life. And so I think like you were so ahead of time, I think, to be thinking this way, because now look where we are. So tell me what thoughts you had that really said solidly in your heart, because you could have done anything else. You could have just opened a studio. You could have done, you know, one-on-one. What was it specifically about the workplace that you thought, hey, I'm going to do this and I'm going to launch Inward Office, which by the way, I love the name of your practice. I do.
It's my husband's. It's my husband's name. He's like the silent, like, you know, genius here too. It used to be Devi Yoga, my middle name, which is my grandmother's middle name and kind of, you know, spoke to that heritage.
Okay.
But Devi is, it's a hard to grasp, you know, and it can be esoteric. It means goddess, you know, yes, I didn't want to continue to go down that path and ostracize people. So he came up with Inward Office. As soon as he said it, I was like, yes, that's
it.
And you know, then I mentioned to you, he's a computer scientist. When you break it down, it's IO, which is also 10, which is, you know, it's just like a very interesting.
Look at that.
Yeah, right?
Wow.
It's, there was something else helping us out that day, I think.
Yeah.
So,
But in it's offices,
well, I was actually thinking about kind of something similar to this, which is, you know, I talk to a lot of workplaces about stress and how to manage stress with yoga and with meditation. And I was like, wow, what's my obsession with stress? Like, why do I really want to do this? And this was before COVID, you know, this was really like, the stress discussion really started in like 2011 to 2013 for me with, and then I started actually getting hired in probably 2015 for that linking up. And I just remember so many actual discussions at the dinner table of my father talking about his stress at work. And, you know, it just, I really went back and remembered that and said, you know, I think that really helped form as a child, my perception that people were really suffering at work. And the only place that he had to let it out was at the dinner table with us. And so I think that was a thread in there. I do think there was an amount of me that was already in the had the nature of a yogi before starting it. But then doing it in the workplace, you know, I don't even know what was the logical reason. I just knew it.
There's
an amount where I just feel like I was fulfilling, you know, my duty, my dharma, like what I was supposed to do, because it was just very clear to me right from the beginning that that was what I was going to do. And to an extent too, when you're doing a studio, there's a personality thing, you know, like you, I mean, you can think right now, like, who are your favorite yoga instructors or what's your favorite studio? There's like a very strong character and personality. And I mean, without discounting that, because we all need a community, I really try hard with Inward Office to have it be reflective of the person, because ultimately the practice is the self-awareness.
Right. Exactly.
Like I don't hire instructors that want all eyes on them. Although in this like Zoom, mm-hmm. you know, video conference, doing it virtually is very different.
Sure.
But the practice isn't meant for you as a student to look at me and all eyes on me and everything mm-hmm. I'm saying. And it's meant to give you some cues and help guide you into your own experience.
Yes. Yes.
And so Inward mm-hmm. Office, instead of being Devi Yoga, which was mm-hmm. personality, which was about me, which was, mm-hmm. you know, for us, it's a lot of how do we give it back to you?
Yes. Oh, that is so beautiful. That is so beautiful. You know, because the thing is, it's there has to be that buy-in, you know, and I wonder if you can speak to how that occurred when you sort of started pitching this to offices, because, you know, traditionally, as you said, it is, you know, okay, workplace wellness, we're going to create mm-hmm. this room and people are going to go into it and whatnot. And it sounds to me, and they're going to do this practice, but it sounds to me like it was really, you know, very much, I don't want to say patient centered, but person focused, person centered. And you're so right about the fact that you can, when you're in a studio, you can get so caught up, first of all, in the studio itself, right? So there's mm-hmm. all the, you know, the accoutrements and the things and that make it pretty and whatnot and the location mm-hmm. and all this. And then there's the instructor and whatnot. And there's something to be said about doing this practice in the environment where the person is experiencing their stress or their tension or needing greater self-awareness. So when you pitched this, or when you went out to sort of to offer your services, how did your immediate community receive it? Like how did that go over?
So I mean, our first clients were definitely the ones that, and now even our best clients, mm-hmm. like the ones that believe in it no matter what the numbers are on a week to week basis, or, you know, say we've got a contract for an indefinite amount of time, mm-hmm. Are the ones that have some kind of self-awareness practice themselves. Mm. So, you know, Shaquana,
yes.
as soon as she met me, she was like, yes.
Yes.
And, you know, as a business, if you're looking at the business side, by the time they're at our door, we've already been recommended and the client is already saying yes. Like they already know they want it. Mm-hmm. But at that point, and the people that were buying in, you know, there was the one level of they're buying into the fitness, they're buying mm-hmm. into the movement. Right. And I always quickly followed that up with the many levels of stress, not mm-hmm. just the physical stress where we're holding it in our body. And then we see it in our health insurance claims as mm-hmm. lower back pain or as migraines or, mm-hmm. But then we've got the physical stress, and we've got all these other layers of it too, which is the mental stress, which you can say is anxiety and depression. And as mm-hmm. soon as you start to link what people are seeing in their, what the organizations see in their health assessments, mm-hmm. I mean, and the fact that yoga being such a holistic practice really does touch on all these things. I mean, the anxiety, the depression, the insomnia, the lower back pain, you know, all the different things. And, mm-hmm. and those are the things that, like I said, the people that work in HR are seeing in their health claims and mm-hmm. that are leading to absenteeism or leading to injury.
Yeah. And even presenteeism, you know, I often try to make that connection, especially with small business owners, because, you know, our bottom line as small business owners is like, you know, there are narrow margins, right? So there's not this huge corporate budget. And presenteeism is probably as much of a problem as absenteeism. You know, people who are there and present in the workplace, but they are just emotionally checked out, right? Or physically checked out.
Can't imagine now,
exactly.
more than any other year.
Like. Exactly, yeah. And how anxiety, you mentioned health claims. So anxiety and the way that it shows up in the physical body, right? Because people don't always come in. I mean, I'm a clinician, right? So people don't always come in and say, oh, hi, Angel, I'm here and I have anxiety. I'd like to have medication for that. They come in with my stomach is so upset. I'm having loose bowel movements, or I feel nauseous all the time, or I have these crazy migraine headaches. And my work in SIVA Health, you know, my background is really more integrative. So I'm always looking at root causes, because it's easy. I could just take my prescription pad all day long and say, hey, here's something for your migraine, and move on to the next person. But because yoga is so foundational to what I do and how I live, I don't want to do that kind of medicine. So it always comes back to what is happening in your life that is creating all of these symptoms. You know, I always have this tree behind me because it's that tree, right? So it's all this stuff that's happening in your life, but what's underneath it in the roots, you know, what's causing all of these symptoms. And I always say that an organization is only as healthy as the people who are in the organization. So you can have this big corporation, this big corporate budget, but if people are present and emotionally checked out, or they're absent and they're emotionally checked out, what's the point? How healthy is the organization? And, you know, I'm really glad that you mentioned something else, that you're not really selling yoga, right? Because the person that you're contacting in that organization is probably already engaged in some mind-body practice or some self-awareness practice of their own. So it's kind of like you're connecting with your ideal client, right? Would you say that your ideal clients are sort of people who already get it?
Yeah, and I mean that there's a level just with Inward Office that it's always been a side job for me. So I've never had to sell it. Luckily, we've had some excellent clients over the years that have been able to support the instructors and supported the mission of Inward Office. But I definitely recognize the need for, you know, that salesmanship, depending on the way one's business is structured.
Right.
Yeah.
So let me ask you this too. How have things grown since 2006, 2010, 2015? Where did you start and where are you now? Are you at capacity? Are you at where, is this like, do you envision taking Inward Office globally? Do you have clients overseas, things like that? What is your vision for Inward Office?
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting question right now, just because we were all in person before March. And our instructors have done some amazing things. So we had a team of about maybe 30 instructors that were under contract. They're all independent contractors. They all work with, you know, studios and gyms and within Inward Office. I mean, in a gig sort of role. And so we had this big group of instructors, and of course COVID hit and everything changed, and we were covering the whole kind of Western New York. So I had some instructors in Buffalo, which is about an hour and a half from here. I had instructors that would travel down to Southern Tier, because, you know, yoga is motivating as an instructor. Not everybody's a yoga instructor, but that's really our core, like our flagship service. And so they would travel down to like Elmira because an instructor had their mom live there, and they would stay overnight and then teach a class. I mean, just in that service of giving, which is just so wonderful. You know, but they're not doing a volunteer. Let's be clear on that. Service of like, they want to bring this to the clients that are seeking it. And so then when COVID hit, we all went virtual, and suddenly our client, like for instance, we work with the school systems in the region, and we'd have to go to the individual schools and hold a weekly class. Well, now we hold a few classes, and all the school systems that buy into their particular health plan join those classes. So it was more of a collective group. And we worked with Paychex locally, which is a national company. They're founded in Rochester. But so I was working with their couple offices here, just holding a few weekly classes. And then COVID hit, we went virtual. And then now the whole country of Paychex offices has access to the programs. And so it's been neat to just see that, because with the virtual classes, we can unite many of the companies that have many offices, you know, under one program. But it's still, you know, I still kind of feel like we're in a transitional phase. I mean, I'm trying to plan out 2020, 2021 and saying, what is this going to look like? Because, right. You know, people are seeking recorded classes. People are seeking Pacific time zone doesn't line up with Eastern time zone for work. So there's a lot of what ifing on my part. So I'm trying to take my best clients and see what they want, because we've always just created our services around this clients we've served.
Sure. A lot of logistics to work out.
Yeah,
a lot of logistics.
Yeah. So rather than like, I don't know about how to answer the at capacity or even, you know, if my husband watches this, he'll be like, you need to know what your, you know, number goals are. I don't know what my number goals are. I'll just put that out there.
Right.
but I think any, you know, more yoga we can bring to more people is fulfilling our mission. We are the first touch for many people trying yoga, which really is one of my big goals, because this might be your opinion too, but my opinion is there's a whole lot more people that haven't done yoga than have. And so we have a huge potential throughout the country to really bring yoga just to more people, but they have to know that it's not acrobatics and that it's not just chanting and it's not Hinduism. They have to know that it's adaptable to like meeting the person where they're at. So
exactly. And that just trickles right over into my next question, partly just going back a little bit when we were talking about the eight limbs of yoga. And, you know, I'm in this program now called the Inner MBA, which is all about just like the building that self-awareness, mindfulness as in leadership and things like this, and embodied leadership, right? And so what I'm wondering is, do you find receptivity in your client base for those other parts of yoga, right? Beyond asana and into that inner work of meditation practice and breathing practices where there isn't any, like you said, acrobatics or any of that kind of thing. Do you have clients who are turning more toward those self-awareness practices, mudra and things like this? Can you speak to that, whether there's interest in that and how you weave that into the offerings?
Yeah, so we definitely do a lot with mindfulness. So I think many of us that are maybe tuning in know that mindfulness became like an HR buzzword or workplace buzzword. And I think looking at it from the outside, you know, I've watched or listened to a podcast or two or read an article or two that people in HR and in wellness circles thought it was like some fad. You know, meditation and yoga have been around so like thousands of years. It's not a fad. It's not a fad. It's just degrees of how much it's integrated into the culture and integrated into like our knowledge base. And so I do see a lot of clients choosing to hold workshops in mindfulness. The way our company does it is it's kind of like more of a premier service. Like we have the weekly yoga classes and then we have a workshop selection and the mindfulness workshops are they're a deeper dive. They're answering the why are we doing this? Like you can walk into an immersive yoga practice and just go in and go into your own space and do your practice and leave and not talk and not reflect. Like you're just doing your practice. With the mindfulness classes, especially the way, I guess I would say I'm the primary mindfulness trainer. I'll go in with a PowerPoint and say like, why are we practicing? What is mindfulness? You know, why is this good for the workplace? What do the research studies say? Okay, now let's practice. And so we get the comments like even recently with a client asking after we did a practice, there's like a little admission, like, I kind of like this, like this actually made me feel really good. I actually meditate, but I've never meditated with all of you before, you know? And so I think people are just like emerging to the self-awareness that they maybe already have, but haven't felt safe to say it and say, well, actually I do have this app on my phone or actually I have tried this before. And, so I just think that there's like an opening, a potential for that. And, and we do integrate breathing practices and relaxation practices really actively since insomnia is a concern and anxiety and depression, and those can really help with those states. again, in the lens of workplaces and what they're seeing on their health assessments. So
exactly. And that's what I want to jump into now. So we're in the midst of this pandemic, and at least here in the United States, I think we've been wrestling with this since probably January, right? So that was when the first, you know, mainstream media started hyping up bringing more attention to what was happening overseas and things like this. Oddly enough, I had traveled in February and we weren't wearing masks or anything like that. So I'm just really grateful that, you know, that neither, you know, anyone in my family got sick. But here we are now down into November. And now what's being spoken about is this thing called pandemic fatigue, right? So I feel like there are people who, you know, initially the idea of working from home was like, oh yeah, I'm so happy. I'm going to be working from home. I'm going to grab my stuff and I'm going to create this garden. And now I'll get to do all the baking I want to do and all of this. Yeah. And now I think people are like feeling really fatigued, you know, the realization that home has become work and work has become home. And there's no line that separates the two. I know in my clinical practice, I'm seeing people who are working well into 8-9 o'clock at night because their thing is, well, what else is there to do? You know, the malls are closed. You know, one of my therapist friends was saying that a lot of people have lost their usual coping mechanism. So there used to be, okay, I'll get off from work and I'll go to the mall, or I'll get off from work and I'll go have some drinks with friends. Things like this. So can you speak to what you're seeing, you know, if there's anything that people are sharing in classes, what are people really feeling? You know, we give these words, anxiety, depression, you know, those are clinical terms, but what are you finding people are really wrestling with, and how is pandemic fatigue showing up in the work that you do?
Well, that's a really good question. How is pandemic fatigue showing up in the work? I mean, one of the thoughts, I won't say that this has come up in class, but one of the thoughts that I think really ties in that pandemic fatigue with the work we do is that recognition that we're actually always in a state of change. Like changes are always happening and our mind is always wrestling with the future and the past. And just right now, it's all very, very much present. Like it's all very much in our consciousness. Like we may have last year not noticed that our mind was like going to, oh, I want to plan this trip, or oh, I want to do this thing, because there was a like a level of safety, right? There was a level of like, I kind of know what's going to happen. I can anticipate A, B, and C things, so I can plan for this vacation. Maybe we went into the past and mulled over or found ourselves grieving over something or mulled over some past decision. And now just everything is like, if that was at like a 10% intensity, it's like all at like 95% intensity, right? Because I can't plan for the future. I can't plan for Thanksgiving, which is in a week. I can't plan for Christmas, which is in 2 weeks, because God knows something might crazy might happen tomorrow. And like all those plans are out the window. And I just feel like everyone's kind of feeling that. And so
that is so on point. Like you are so right about that.
And and to me, it's just like, I don't want this to be, I don't think it's cynical. I don't think that, I feel like it's this, how do I want to put this? Like for so long, I feel like I've been educating people about stress and about what their minds do. And all of a sudden this year, everyone got it. That's really funny. But like, it was like, if you didn't actually believe that your mind goes to the future and the past and actually gets scared and doesn't feel a sense of safety. So that's why it plans for the future. And that's why it like rehashes the past so that the brain can be calm right now. Like that's all these things I've been, I feel like trying to share with people, it's just very present. And so I think there is more need for the work and there's more need for being kind and open to actually what's going on inside of us. So my response to would be, those coping mechanisms might have gone away or changed. Well, they've gone away because they changed, right?
Right.
And then we want to find another way to hide
Yes.
And workaholism is a great way to hide.
Oh,
it's a great
my
way.
God,
because,
yes.
Because there's external recognition built in there. If I'm working till at 9 at night, and then my boss is like, wow, you did a great job on that. It's like, yeah, I put in the time and somebody recognized I did something. And that's like a whole nother discussion.
Oh, but my gosh, Marla. No, keep going with it. You are so right. No, you are so right. Yeah, that external validation, that look at me who's working from home and doing extra and showing up and whatnot. And then there's that predictability, right? You can control.
Yeah.
This is something I can control. I can work until midnight. I can do this paper. I can edit this, whatever. You know, it's, and yeah, workaholism is oh my gosh, like it's such a phenomenal coping mechanism, unhealthy, but a coping mechanism nonetheless for so many people. And what do you think mindfulness and meditation do for that propensity, you know, for that personality type or that propensity? How does that speak to me? Like, I don't want to say scientifically, but I mean, your knowledge in this is just so vast. And I just really would love for you to share with people, what does meditation do for that? You know, how does meditation, you know, someone who has that propensity toward workaholism and things like that, how can meditation be helpful, and yoga, but in a larger way?
So I don't want to like focus just on workaholism, but that anything that we aholism, right? It could be food that's our coping technique that's overindulgent. It could be our work that's overindulgent. It could be our sleeping that's overindulgent. Whatever it is that, you know, we're just off balance in a way, right? And yoga's, the goal of yoga is to bring us into balance.
Yes.
Whatever that means, right? Because I'm sure there's people listening or what have you that are like, balance,
what does that look like? Yeah.
What is balance? Relaxation. Mm-hmm. What is relaxation? And so the knowledge that, so I think that yoga and meditation, so this deepening of self-awareness brings to light and brings into consciousness what our patterns are. Mm-hmm. And so our like reflection on the fact that I spent 40 hours in the first 3 days of my work week. Maybe that wasn't that wasn't in balance. And why am I so tired now that it's Thursday? Well, maybe it's because I spent all that time. Just that opening to noticing what's there and what our experience is the fruit of the practice.
Yes.
So I do, you know, years ago, I used to think that meditation was like, right, a bliss state, or that an empty state, or a state of feeling the balance. And now I know it can be just sitting there and sitting with all your crazy thoughts. And it can be one day like that, and one day like where you're noticing a pattern, and another day where you're in a bliss state. And really it's just about paying attention to what's under the surface when all day long we're just busy doing other stuff.
We are we are so far away. And you know, I say that a lot, like when people, especially just bringing it back to my clinical practice, when I say, have you tried meditation? Now, I've been practicing long enough to know that meditation can bring about a lot for people. You know, some people, the whole idea of just sitting and, you know, zoning out, that's not what it is. And I think that's the first thing that people conjure up in their minds. And so I invite people to think about walking meditation or standing meditation sitting, you know, because the body is different. There are energy centers throughout the body, and we can conjure up energy and get energy really going. For some people, sitting does that. For some people, sitting is just the opposite. So I invite people to explore different ways of practicing meditation.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, I never, you know, I avoid saying that this is going to cure that, or this is going to fix that. What it is going to do is create more awareness of what that is, so that then you can begin to explore how that is showing up in your life physically, how it's showing up in your life mentally, in your relationships. It as you said, it opens the door for exploring more of what our life looks like, and especially work life too, because as we said in the beginning, so much of our life is spent in work, at work, or thinking about work, right?
Yeah.
And I think in the workplace, there's such an opportunity to just do that. Just like, let's just be present right here in this work environment. And in this work environment, as you said, with inward office, because it's different when you get home. It's a different practice when it's at home or in the studio versus when it's in the office.
Yeah, it is. And it's an interesting thing too. I mean, doing it in a place like when we were in person, doing it in a place where maybe somebody feels most of their stress is a totally different practice than when you get to leave the stress and go to the studio and be in a beautiful space.
Exactly.
And then it's like, it's a little like it helps with the unwinding. Mm-hmm. And then now in COVID era where, you know, I work over there and I eat over there and I sleep over there, right? Like it's all right here. Then it's a totally different version of how do I find a new technique? And I really think like part of the big work that we do or that I try to convey to people is sometimes your coping techniques are just worn out, you know, and you need to just find some new things.
Yes.
You know, I'm the first to stand in front of the room and say, what's your coping technique? Mine's an IPA. Like, what's yours, you know?
Right.
I love my beer in the evening. And, you know, most days it's my one mindful beer and I make the decision when I'm going to have it. And I really enjoy it. Like
I enjoy it.
But, and you know, that's my like crutch or what have you, like, I'm not going to say I'm a non-drinking, non-meat eating yogi,
right?
Like, we're keeping it real over here.
Right. And you know, there's something so refreshing about giving yourself permission to just be human, you know, just to be, to show up in the world exactly as you are.
Yeah.
You know, I was talking with a patient recently and, you know, when we talk about these buzzwords, so the buzzword of self-care, I know you've heard that, you know, and it's the kind of thing where, you know, it's like, okay, going to get a massage or going to get nails done or going to just more going and more doing, right? So I try to encourage people to think about self-care in a way that doesn't involve more running and more responsibility and more having to show up in the world in a way that is not authentically you. Like mindfulness is the root of self-care. And so, you know, I think about just the fact that if we can change that language and change how people think about mindfulness and think about meditation and self-care, and just realizing that it's just really more about how you're showing up for yourself and to yourself and the rest of the world. I know we don't have a whole lot of time. What I want to ask too is for larger corporations that really have a large budget for something, you know, a big, you know, a weekly program or biweekly program makes sense. How can the smaller business owners incorporate something like this into their business? Do you work with smaller business owners who may not have large budgets, or let's say they have no budget at all and can't, you know, afford to bring someone in?
Yeah.
What would your recommendation be for a smaller business to just even introduce something like this for its in their workplace?
Yeah. I mean, to be frank, between you and I, we're not that expensive.
Okay.
I probably need to raise our rates. Like, I'll be frank.
Okay.
But so we do work with like big businesses and small businesses.
Good.
There are some of our, you know, clients that have stuck around a few years are 50 to 100 employees. So, you know, still working with the smaller ones. But usually what happens is that the smaller ones, their budget is not a wellness budget, you know, it's coming out of a manager's budget or it's coming out of a morale or a, you know, there's not like a defined program per se. And so I do think that there's a lot of free resources. The question is like, how do you unify it? Because let's say I'm a small business owner that wants to bring some of these things, like I can throw a bunch of things at my employee, but that's not my main job. And so for the businesses that we work with where there isn't a wellness person, like a devoted wellness person on their team, often they're using a wellness consultant from their health insurance that that's helping to link us up and bring some direction to the program. But like our company does a lot of just helping them kind of create something unified. I do like that there's so many free resources, but I do think that the problem is you need something to bring them all together.
Exactly.
Like, if we just did like, let's do a mindfulness day and let's try some meditations, like how do we make it stick? Because the thing about the yoga and the meditation and any of these awareness practices is that they have to be regular. You have to do them so that you've got like the tank full so that when the craziness comes, you're like, you've already got some buoyancy or you've got some energy to deal with it. And so like the meditation class that I lead, you know, I'm very frank with people every single week. I'm like, how's your practice going? And even if they've got no practice except for the class that we're going to, like, we just have to keep kind of chipping away. Like, how are you going to keep your practice up? What are you doing on a daily or a weekly basis? And so if somebody wanted to do something for free, it's just creating some kind of regularity within the organization. That fosters the attitude of mindfulness or yoga or self-care, because it can be implicit. It doesn't have to be explicit that way.
Exactly. That's such a wonderful response because, you know, accountability is important. Consistency is important. Creating space for people to come back and have offer feedback or have questions that need to be answered. And, you know, I want to emphasize to listeners that, you know, this is important work. You know, this is knowing where the foot should be placed, where it shouldn't be placed. This is energy centers in the body. This is understanding the mechanics of the body, you know, adapting the practice for people who may be shorter, taller, different body sizes, different capabilities, things like this. So the idea of just, oh, let's just, you know, get some free resources while they're free. And to your point about, you know, the quality of what we're getting, you know, free, and then the consistency, sometimes we can be doing more harm than good when we're just sort of looking for things and sort of throwing things together rather than having a professional like yourself to come in and help make sense of this. And, you know, the whole point of it is to see people's lives change. So to see them evolve, to give them what they need in a way that makes sense and that is tailored to, you know, tailored to them, but also tailored to the workplace and things like that. So, you know, that's a really good point that just sort of tossing together some things and no one kind of really is there to be a soundboard or to make this make sense for the employee ultimately then does do a disservice, I think, to the organization and to the employee as well.
Yeah. I mean, it's just not as wise of a use of dollars. Like if I'm going to pull some things together that happen only once, it's just not, it's not integrated. And this is, like this to me, that difficult question that I'll ask the employers is like, you know, they'll say, oh, how long to run a program? And I'm like, how long can we run a program? Like, can we go for a year initially, because it's the long-term, we're in it for the long haul,
not
one-time workshop. Cause that gives people a taste of like, oh, that's what this is like, but doesn't build the muscle, you know? But, oh, Angel, you brought to that like thought to me, there was recently, you know, some article that came across my email that was like about the importance of stretching from like a big, appears big health organization.
Right.
And they had this horrible picture. It was like everyone was doing stretches wrong. And it was like women in high heels doing forward bends with rounded backs. And I was like, what? And I was like, how can you talk about the importance of stretching and have such an awful picture?
Right.
And you know, there's that part of me that's like, I got to get there. I got to email them back and educate them. And then there's the part of me that's like, I guess the people that are going to hire them are going to get that kind of service.
And you know, you're so right, because here again, I see the same thing with Tai Chi and Qigong and whatnot. Yeah. And I'm just like, you know, it's really, really, a picture says a thousand words, right? And so you look at these pictures and, you know, you're just like, wow, who wrote this or who put this together? And, you know, sometimes these things go viral and they get shared all over the place and whatnot. And you're like, and I think on some level, there is some responsibility, you know, for us to speak out and, you know, do that sort of letter to the editor and say, you know, I appreciate such and such, but just for clarity's sake, you know, that this is actually not. And then the other thing is too, when people equate stretching with yoga, right? Because that's two different things.
Oh, that's
too.
A great point. Yeah.
You know, it's not stretching. Like, oh, if that's what you are doing, that's fine. But yoga practice is so much more than that. One of the things I've been really emphasizing in my own practice is restorative yoga. Like that people have a nighttime practice because
great.
The insomnia that we were talking about, people are really, really, I mean, thankfully, the election is behind us now, as far as I'm concerned, it's behind us. But, but people had horrible insomnia, you know, throughout that whole process, too. And I really, really encourage people to have some sort of restorative yoga at nighttime. But with the knowing that it is not just stretching, right? It's so much more than that. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. That does lead to a great sound sleep.
Yeah, it does.
Sort of pose too before bed.
Yep. I know that we're, like I said, I want to be mindful of our time together. If you can speak to really quickly, if you can, how important is it for, you know, just those listening audience in terms of immune health, this pandemic specifically, we know about stress, anxiety, all those kinds of things. Can you just speak briefly to just how useful yoga is for immune health all by itself?
Immune health all by itself. Yeah. I mean, the research study, one of those like foundational research studies on mindfulness and mindfulness meditation was how well psoriasis patients healed during treatment or how fast their treatments went. Well, they healed after treatment when they were doing meditation during the actual UV treatment. And they were, I think it was sped up four times as much when they were doing mindfulness meditation. And so there is an immune system response. I mean, not everybody agrees, but there's a science of epigenetics where it basically says, you know, if you create the conditions for health in the body through things like right breathing, right exercise, integrating, you know, practices of self-awareness like meditation and yoga, that you create the healing, the natural healing response of the body to emerge, because ultimately your body wants to be in a constant state of healing and health.
Yes.
So what happens is we have like dampers on it. If we have, you know, if we're eating badly, if we're doing things that just throw us completely off balance, if we're not aware of our patterns, if our patterns are there, our negative habits are there, and they're slowly chipping away at the good stuff. And so really, I think that the key part here is that our body naturally wants to be in balance. It naturally wants to be healthy.
Yes.
And that we just have so many layers of conditioning or opinion or personality or whatever it is covering up that inclination.
Absolutely. And if we can get a good night's rest, you know, I talk a lot about sleep health and, you know, and the immune system, what happens in the brain when we're sleeping at night, you know, all that cleanup that goes on in the brain, that vagal nerve, you know, that parasympathetic nervous system, all of it is just so, so important for our immune health. Really is. So in my final round, because I know that I want to be mindful, as I said, of time, I always ask for a tip, tool, and strategy, or tip, tool, or strategy. So if there's a tip, a tool, or strategy that you can offer to the audience, and I'm specifically to business owners, you know, or a leadership or human resources people who are interested in having, you know, inward office in their office, if they're interested in, you know, reaching out to you, please tell us too in these final moments how people can reach you, and let's sort of wrap up there.
Okay. Well, I do have like three things that people can do.
Oh,
so
good.
Is that okay to share?
Yay! Yes.
Okay. Great. Because you told me that we can do a little something.
Yes.
So I mean, as far as people reaching out to me. Yes, of course, inwardoffice.com is our client facing website, although right, we're a small business. It's like me in the office and I have someone else that helps me, you know, part-time, but it's where, you know, it's not quite as updated as I'd like it to be. Like it's very much phone call to phone call and email to email right now, but inwardoffice.com and the phone number there reaches me directly. So it's very, very much a direct service in many ways.
Very nice.
But yeah, a couple of things that I wanted to share. One of them is massage balls.
Ooh.
My favorite massage balls are roll method balls.
Okay.
So lots of people do different kinds of self-massage and they'll do it with golf balls or tennis balls or lacrosse balls. And these are just a little, like they've got a little bit of sponginess, I guess, maybe is the word. But they were made, they're rubbery. So they grip the skin. You could kind of see, let's see.
Nice.
You can see it here. They grip and they can move the skin because they're rubbery. And I think massage balls are just like a must have in the office and especially in the home office. A lot of different things. The roll method ones I like a lot because one, you've got this little sleeve they go in and my hair isn't up. So bear with me here. One of those things you can do here is against a wall, put these on
nice.
The wall and you lean up and then you just roll them up and down or take one of them, put it right on the occipital ridge right here and then just lean on it. And it's kind of intuitive. I mean, we teach classes on how to use them. You can go to the Roll Method website and download workshops. But this is kind of like my go-to, like if I'm feeling fidgety, like in a really long Zoom meeting, or fidgety because I'm a bystander in a Zoom meeting and I have to like smile and nod, but I'm so antsy, you know, I can just,
I love that.
I can take out one of these and roll it on my feet. I can roll it on my thighs. It's kind of like one of those things, like I think self-kindness is really important right now. Yes. And it can be kind of like a kind and compassionate thing, nurturing thing you can do for yourself. So I definitely highly recommend these. It's just like a tool. You can do them all over the body. There's plenty of resources out
there. That is so nice. I like that. I will be getting that.
I'll send you one, Angel. We'll talk after this. I have a lot of supplies that are getting no use right now. Another thing that I wanted to share, I'm going to have to just adjust for a minute.
Sure.
Okay, I'm going to put my chair here. So again, thinking of most of us in our meeting space and working from home.
Okay.
So there are a lot of companies that invested heavily in the ergonomic chairs and tables and having the right equipment. You know, from my clients, I've heard a range of how people are working, that that some offices supplied some things, some gave money towards setting up a home office, a whole range, right? The biggest thing I noticed right away for my husband and I was how badly designed our home office equipment is. Terrible. Back pain immediately, shoulder pain immediately.
Same here.
And so the one big key that I would hope everybody would do. So I have this meditation cushion. Okay. It's actually made by a local artist here. So I absolutely love it. It's filled with it's filled with like buckwheat. So it doesn't lose its shape, which if you get a cotton one, it will eventually lose its shape. And it's really high. So it's probably 6 inches. Sitting on this at your table makes loads of difference for the alignment of your shoulder to your elbow to your table.
Because pretty much,
if you're sitting at a kitchen table or any of those, any of the, like just standard non-ergonomic design furniture, what's happening is you're kind of like, it's up too high. So you're doing this kind of thing. Your elbows are kind of going out to the side or they're going forward. So this is super simple.
Oh my gosh.
For better alignment. And it's not so bad on the knees too. You've got less of a bend in them. So that's one. And then the other big one, again, this is a work from home. I've been in a Zoom meeting way too long and mm-hmm. I need to stretch something, but I still mm-hmm. have to pay attention.
mm-hmm, right.
So let me see if I can get everything here. You might not see my full head. So mm-hmm. what we're going to do here is just a passive quad stretch.
Okay.
So you're just going to put your foot up on here mm-hmm. while you're doing the standing version of the meeting. So,
oh, Marla, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you're going to put your computer up higher. Like I just use a plastic bin.
Okay.
And I'm just going to put my leg at a 90 degree bend on mm-hmm. the chair.
Okay. Yes.
And so for most of us that are sitting at these angles, mm-hmm. all along, doing everything mm-hmm. at these angles, mm-hmm. we need to stretch the front, the hip flexors, the quads.
Yes.
And this yes. is just so super simple.
And that is
and it's
so
passive.
Easy. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Getting that blood flow circulating and everything. Simple modifications.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's just those little things, but then done consistently
mm-hmm.
that are
mm-hmm.
the most important.
Oh my gosh. Yes. And that's a whole nother conversation. And hopefully we can jump back on again in the days ahead after maybe the holidays or something, we can talk about, you know, more of these practical tips and yeah. tools and strategies for people as we continue working from home and making these adjustments and things like that. So thank you so yeah. much for sharing that. I'd love to jump back on again
as time permits me too.
For you, because I know you're super busy. Yeah. Yeah. Marla, thank you so much for joining us today. Really, it's yeah. all about helping people get fit and functional for life. And we're talking about mind, body, spirit, wellness, yeah. and fitness. So thank you so much for preserving
yeah,
this afternoon
you.
Time
thank
for me.
You.
Really, really. Yeah. All right. So those who are listening, you can find Marla on LinkedIn. I know that's where we connect. And inwardoffice.com. She'd be happy to talk to you about what you can do in your workplace and in your life. To experience more of yoga and deepening your own practice if yeah. you have one. Yeah. Thank you so much, Marla.
Thanks, Angel. Thank you for the opportunity.
Soon. You're yeah. welcome. Very welcome. Take good care.
You too.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.